I wanted to start with this cartoon because I realize blockchain is slightly overhyped. And it's also, as Eefke mentioned, quite a complex topic. So that's actually a difficult combination to immediately believe in the concept. And when I started with blockchain, I also had my doubts. But I can honestly say that having worked in this industry for 20 years, I think this is the technology that can have a profound impact on the way we work and the way we service our community. So hopefully after this session, you will at least partly agree with that. So let's start with a good scientific practice, the definition. Indeed, it's not blockchain is not Bitcoin, it is not even cryptocurrencies, but it's basically a new way of storing data. It's a new type of database, a revolutionary new type. First of all, it's decentralized, and it means there is no single curator, there's no middleman needed anymore. So in current databases, you need somebody to ensure the quality and ensure the trust. For example, in case of financial transactions, you need a bank. With blockchain, this trust is achieved in a very different way, so there's no middleman needed anymore. The second aspect is that it's shared, it's a distributed database, and at the same time, it's immutable, so it cannot be changed retroactively. And the third one is that it's transparent. It's a transparent database, but still it's pseudonymous, so real identities do not have to be revealed. So how can this technology change? How can it impact our industry? How can it make us serve our customers better? Well, for that, of course, we have to again realize what our role is. Our role is to support the scientific community in communication. Communication, of course, being an extremely important aspect of science, being a truly collaborative effort. And how do we do that? By organization and by technology. And what used to be quite straightforward, we had our printing press evolved into platforms, online database, and the internet. But the way we organize this communication has its flaws, and we talked about it this morning, yesterday. There are recognized problems that we have in serving our customers. And I just want to highlight four of them, because I promise you, all of them could potentially be solved by the blockchain. So first is reproducibility, something that was mentioned yesterday and in Ned's talk as well. It's really a very, very a large problem, large challenge we're having. And to an extent, you can explain that because it has a legacy of the print era. So scientists start to communicate their results at the point of publication of the article. But everything that went into that article, for example, the research design or the peer review or the data, is traditionally not shared, which leads to a lack of transparency and therefore a lack of reproducibility. Related to that is the crisis around peer review. Also, a lack of transparency there. It's simply not a process that is traditionally shared amongst researchers. It's an opaque process. And sometimes publishers simply have to be trusted that the process takes place after all. Related to that, there is a huge problem with recognizing the reviewers. You can't recognize reviewers for the important work they do if that data is simply not available. The third challenge is limited and outdated metrics. I like the quote underneath, is that the current metrics, the current way of recognizing researchers, is evolved out of the limitation of the print publishing. You can build metrics with the data points you have, and basically now it's the number of publications and the number of citations, but we all know that science is much more than number of publications, citations. There's a lot of activity that has a genuine scientific value, but there are no data points for that. The fourth is a more challenging one maybe, but that is a crisis around business models, or maybe even broader, a commercial crisis. Interesting to see that yesterday a lot of the talks was about open access. On the one hand, we have the subscription model, which comes with its challenges, high profit margins that are hard to explain, but also, of course, a lack of openness. Not all research is available to the research community. The problem with piracy that we talked about yesterday as well. Then we have open access, but it's also causing its own set of problems, the predatory publishers, of course, being one of them. So how could blockchain be applied? more specifically, how could blockchain solve or address these issues? I'm going to mention only three. There are many more ideas in the report, but also in the talks that will follow my talk. But I just wanted to highlight three possible applications of blockchain and how they could solve these problems we have currently. So let's think again how an average researcher, the workflow of an article. Somebody writes their paper in Word. They will maybe share their data sets on Figshare. It goes to editorial manager. It's hosted, it's published and hosted on the publisher website. And then some data about usage and citations will be stored in different databases. So all different databases that are basically not connected. So what if you would have one repository, one database that shares all that, that stores all these events, all these steps in the workflow? So the moment that a researcher creates a research design, the peer review process, the review reports, the data sets, and then the publications, of course, and the citations and the usage. So what if there will be one repository that stores all this information? Wouldn't that be a great thing? Yes, it will be a great thing. But why don't we have it? Because in the current technology, we would need a curator. We would need a single institution that would basically manage this database. And there is, again, the question of trust. Who would we trust as a community to play that role? It's very hard. Who would be willing to do this? And who would be able to do it? But with blockchain, you could have this database without this single, curator, which is a big limitation for realizing this. Think about the enormous advantages that this single repository of scientific events would be. Science would be reproducible much better because we would have a data trail, a trail of all the events, of all the steps that went into the research. We could look at the peer review process. We could see, validate that the review process has taken place. So the entire process would be much more transparent and much more open and therefore address the issues we have around reproducibility, for example. But also think about metrics. We are now have to work with basically two data points. That's the number of publications and citations. But once we have a more complete picture of the research activities, we can build metrics that are more representative of all the activities that the researchers do. Sunker will talk more about this specific aspect, but two more. dissemination. Both the current models that we have, that is the subscription model and open access model, come with its own set of problems, but also are quite complex when you think about it. The streams of revenue, usage, research, download accounting, etc. To an extent, we have these models because of a limitation of our current technology. So what if you have a much more simple business model? What if you could connect or integrate micropayments with usage? This is something that is already developed by some platforms. And it would make the business model much more straightforward. You would make micropayments per usage, which would make the business model much more simple, much more straightforward, and therefore probably more sustainable. Another advantage is that this usage by micropayments is that it would be able to manage digital rights much easier. Now we need complex organizations to manage these rights, but things like reuse and permissions could be arranged on the blockchain in an easy way using, for example, smart contracts. Another advantage of having this platform where content is disseminated is that the counting of usage becomes much easier and much simple. The third, the cryptocurrency. There they are. We talked about micropayments as a way to get your content. But what if we would have tokens that we would researchers could use to download papers, but also these tokens we could give them for specific research activities? For example, if they do review, they get tokens. If they are part of an editorial board, they get tokens. And in that way, we could incentivize researchers for things that are very difficult to incentivize at the moment in our current model. You get tokens when you do a review. You get maybe tokens when you contribute to an article, when you do statistical analysis. And you can use these tokens to buy services or download your paper. So this way you can create an economy around science, and even funding could take place using these cryptocurrencies. Again, some rough ideas, more ideas, of course, in the talks after me, but also in the report. The big question is hype or game changer? It's not a hype. It's a hype, but it's more than a hype, and I hope you agree with it. The technology is very relevant to our industry, and it can really be applied. Whether it will be a game changer is a separate question, of course, because the way we work didn't evolve over decades, if not hundreds of years, and with that comes legacy on the level of organization, but also of culture. So the question whether this will be a game changer depends on many factors. One of them, of course, is how are we going to apply this? Are we going to overhaul the entire system? Not very likely, but maybe we can use the blockchain to address particular issues that we're facing, for example, around reproducibility or around peer review. And the interesting question, of course, is how will we as a community deal with it? Will we embrace it? And will we use it and see how we can utilize the technology to improve our service? Or will the disruption come from outside? And there are actually examples of this disruption that came up the last couple of months. Very concretely, where are we now? A lot of good ideas, for example, the Blockchain for Science, a think tank from Sunke, who will talk with a lot of very good ideas that we used in the report as well. Some concrete applications already active in this market around content sharing and content dissemination, a library and Decent, but also Catalysis, who will speak this morning. And these systems are more focused on other areas of publishing, for example, newspaper publishing, that suffer a lot, of course, with the shift of revenue allocation from the content producers to the social media giants. But again, it can be applied to our industry as well. And very interesting, at the time we published the report, two very interesting startups came up, Science Route and Pluto, outside from our industry, so real disruptors. And they're attempting to do a lot of the things that we mentioned in the report. So what should we do? We should discuss this technology, as we do today, and see how we can improve our service to researchers. But also we should experiment, we should test, we should learn. For this reason, we at Digital Science launched the Catalyst Grant specifically for blockchain a few months ago. We closed the we closed it this Monday, and we have over 50 really interesting submissions. I think really reflecting the huge potential of this technology, from cryptocurrencies to new dissemination models, to new ways to do peer review, to even cryptocurrencies and new ways to fund research. So I'll leave it at that. End of January, we will have the outcome of this. We announce the winner. In the meantime, more ideas in the presentation after we end the report. And if you have any ideas, suggestions, please contact me, because we're very interested to have the conversation with you. Thank you.